Hello, this is Pushpa Bector. I'm the Executive Director for DLF Shopping Malls.
And hello, this is Karthik Malhotra. Pushpa Bector, it's a pleasure having you on this podcast. Well, to begin with, Pushpa, let me ask you, and the question is really blunt, because the retail sector has taken the blow of COVID-19 straight on the chin. How is DLF as a group coping with the pandemic?
See, DLF is a mature organization. We have seen quite a few, crises before, 2008 being one of them. You would know that we had opened our malls, leased malls business during 2008-2009 crisis. We dealt with that well, and I'm confident that we deal with this also because we've got more experience now over these 13-14 years. What I can tell you is that the staff, which is the human capital, is the most important thing, and they are motivated. In the malls business, the malls have to still be maintained. So we have a skeletal staff maintaining the staff mall even today. And the staff is fully charged up, motivated. They're actually preparing for the post-COVID era. So not just data and scenario building, but really more on ground on how do we make the difference when we step out, open the mall, in post-COVID new era. What will the consumer want and how are they going to be prepared for it is really the task ahead for all of us. So one of the norms that we are almost finalizing is we won't allow more than one person to every 70 or 75 square feet GLA, which means that the number of people who are in the property with that kind of spacing in every shop, every common area, we are confident that social distancing then will be maintained in a much more seamless fashion, unlike in high street. A mall is far more equipped to deal with not just social distancing, but also sanitization. A high street has got its limitations. In a mall, sanitization is possible and very highly possible with the trained staff that we already have. So the staff now is getting retrained in terms of superior sanitization protocol. We are looking at new products. There are many products that we are evaluating currently, be it thermal imaging, be it high sanitization products, which can stay surfaces to be sanitized for more than 12 hours. And we are also looking at how do we help our retailers. Because it's very important to collaborate in this crisis and work along with them. So we are really talking to them on an everyday basis. I talk to at least 8 retailers to understand what's happening, how are they doing it, how can we help them in tackling with this pandemic.
So help me visualize, Pushpa. I mean, if I were to take the DLF Mall of India in Noida, for example, and that's where I live, if I go to a movie hall, I'm sure it's going to be the last one to recover. But if I were to go to a movie hall or if I were to go to your food court, how do you maintain social distancing in an environment like that?
So the way all our consumer research is telling me 2-3 things which are interesting, both from the China model, and Dubai has just about opened, so I wouldn't go too much into Dubai, but the China model. The footfall will drop to around 50% or 60%. But the interesting part is that the sale is going to be higher. The conversion will be higher because who will we attract, Karthik? It will be the serious shopper, a person who actually wants something to be purchased. People will come in typically on a mission mode. This is what we see in China. So our job then in the first 2-3 months will be to make mall the most convenient, safe, assured spot for the consumer to get what he or she wants. And that will bring about the consumer confidence.
Right. So would it make sense then to perhaps explore malls being open 24 hours a day to still be able to accommodate similar footfalls as before and while maintaining social distancing? So is there merit in exploring a 24-hour working day for malls?
Karthik, actually, we are doing things the reverse. I believe you look at the curfew, even today, 7 p.m. to 7 a.m. is on curfew mode across India, even if it's a green zone. We are actually, when we reopen the mall, possibly we'll reopen it with a shortened time. Maybe it will be from 12 o'clock in the afternoon to 9 o'clock at night. so that a consumer feels safe to come in at that point in time. And we are talking only the first 2 months, when it is important that A, there is no spike in the cases. We have to support what the government's initiatives have been in order to ensure that the spike in cases do not happen. And once those 2 months are tidied over, and I do believe that the cinema, yes, will be the last one to open. The bars will also open a little late. But if the consumer confidence builds, this will be a trajectory which will go up and not have a sort of a zigzag form. And it's important that we build the trajectory in a careful but sure manner. I think that's the key. If all our consumer research is saying that the moment the malls reopen, what will they do? They'll go and try their favorite dishes in their favorite restaurant, possibly on a takeaway basis, or maybe, you know, out of a 10-member family, maybe two of them will venture out. And, you know, that's really what the consumer research is telling us.
But Pushpa, I want to understand, so you've given a great sense of what is in it for the consumer and for the mall. But what about the retailers housed within the mall? How confident are they of the situation becoming better and becoming better, hopefully soon? And secondly, how are they coping at a time like this? Because they've got fixed costs too. They've got rents to pay and they've got salaries to pay. And they've got absolutely zero revenue at a time like this. So what is their confidence like in a bounce back and hopefully a soon enough bounce back?
Yes, it's a tough time for them as much as it is for us. We have to recognize that. It is, I don't like to use the word too much, but it is an unprecedented crisis. And hence, you know, it's something that they are also battling with. You know, what I see, however, is that big brands, the good brands, feel that their brand saliency is so high that consumers will miss wearing that particular brand and will come back. They also believe that, yes, there will be a dip in the both the store footfall as well as, you know, the number of people who come in and purchase. But they are very confident that by October, things should be kind of back to normal.
So Pushpa, I just want to understand, you know, you spoke about a lot of technology infusion. So do you think retailers are equipped right now, since they've seen no revenue for a couple of months now, to be able to make those investments?
I think more than having gizmos, it's more important that there is frequent sanitization. There's frequent assurance to the consumer that, hey, I am being looked after. I think that's more important. Right. Yes, there will be an added cost. No one's saying there wouldn't be. But it should not be astronomical in nature, is my sense.
And do you also anticipate a large-scale migration to e-commerce platforms now? Do you see some talk in the circles that you sit in with the retailers now, with people looking at e-commerce far more seriously now than they did before?
Let me tell you, they know that when in Delhi NCR or Mumbai, the key pockets, there isn't going to be a migration on a long-term basis. They were, you know, the number that they give me is currently they're sitting at around 8% or 10% of their complete retail pack is coming through e-commerce. This may in the short run, in the short run of 3 to 6 months, they believe can double and then it'll come down again. That's the sense that I'm getting. But the key trend that I'm also getting is that omni-channel retailing is here to stay. So omni-channel retailing is really if, ship from the shop, it need not be purely e-commerce because e-commerce does not give the touch and feel benefit. And I think omni-channel retailing, however, does. It gives the logistical benefit as well as the touch and feel benefit for the consumer. So their trend and what they tell me is omni-channel retailing may be the new trend that they will invest in far more than pure e-commerce.
Pushpa Bector, many thanks for taking time out and joining us on this podcast.
Pleasure.